Bismillah, walhamdulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and welcome to this new talk about the famous ayah, or one of the famous ayat. Allah and His angels do their salat on the Prophet, so you who believe also do your salat on the Prophet. It is a well-known ayah. This ayah is the source or the foundation of people saying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam every time they mention the name of the messenger or an attribute or anything that regards him. They always add at the end of his name or attribute sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah issued this instruction to a people that lived with the messenger. The people very well understood Allah's instruction. Allah does His salat, Him and the angels do something, and then He orders the believers to do that very same thing that Allah and the angels do. However, when you look in our books of tafsir and the hadith and the arguments of the scholars and the different school of thoughts and all that kind of stuff, you find that the scholars actually disagree on this instruction. What does it exactly mean? What does Allah mean when He says, do your salat on the messenger? So much so that some of them have made it compulsory. Every time you say the name of Muhammad or messenger or prophet of Allah, you must say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is the foundation of this sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But this brings us to some questions which we'll see the answers to later on. If the instruction was that Allah and the angels do say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam every time Allah mentions the name of Muhammad or attribute, prophet or messenger, then when He instructed the believers to copy Him and the angels, all they did was to say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the issue is resolved. But that is not the case. The argument is really fierce between the scholars, so much so then when you want to understand the meaning of sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, people have no clue, especially the Arabs. In English, it has been translated to peace and blessings be upon him, which is total nonsense. It's absolutely wrong. Because once you say peace on somebody, because that somebody is going through a war or a fight or some kind of distress, and you want a peace for them. And the blessings then come from something else, as opposed to not being cursed. Satan is cursed, he's not blessed. A prophet is blessed, but not cursed. So what did Allah exactly mean when He says that Allah and His angels do their salat upon the prophet? Why not do their salat upon a messenger? Why not upon Muhammad? Why did Allah mention the title of prophets? If you look to the English, if you want to see the meaning of this ayah 56 from Surah 33 Al-Ahzab, and you go, for example, you speak English, and you go to a website like Quran.com, and you want to see what it means. How did the people translate this? Well, guess what? You will find a big difference in the arguments that they present, and I will go through them in a little bit. Before proceeding, I want to remind you of something that Allah said about the Quran, about the might of this Quran, and why the Quran must be our first source and our last source and the only source of our Islam. Allah states, telling His messenger, وَمَا يَتَّبِعُ أَكْثَرُهُمْ إِلَّا ظَنًّا, and most of them, i.e. the Arabs that were not believing and who used to fight the messenger and argue with him and all the arguments, Allah is telling the messenger, and most of them follow nothing but conjectures, assumptions. They have no final authentic proof. And then Allah adds, إِنَّ الظَّنَّ لَا يُغْنِي مِنَ الْحَقِّ شَيْئًا. Certainly, conjectures do not suffice against the truth in any way, Because the truth is a fact that exists. Conjectures, assumptions, and all that kind of stuff are just mere ideas. They have no physical presence. So when it comes, when you bring the Quran and anything else apart from the Quran, only the Quran is the absolute truth. Anything else is nothing but conjectures, assumptions, and all that stuff and claims. Then Allah adds, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ بِمَا يَفْعَلُونَ. Certainly Allah is fully aware of what they do. And then he adds something extremely, extremely powerful, extremely, I don't know what kind of term I want to use here. Because what Allah says after these few words should have been sufficient for our people, the people of old, to understand what Allah said here, and they should never ever have added on top of the Quran. Look what Allah says. وَمَا كَانَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ أَنْ يُفْتَرَى مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. And this Quran could never have been produced by any other than Allah. It's an impossibility that this Quran could have or would have or might have been produced by anyone else than Allah. And by saying this, Allah innocents the messenger that he is not. The Quran doesn't come from him. He is only a tool that transmits what Allah wants to you. And then he says, Allah says, وَلَكِن تَصْدِيقَ الَّذِي بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ, i.e. the Quran is a corroboration of what is present with him, i.e. the prophecy of the messenger. The Quran is the evidence to prove that Muhammad is truly a messenger from Allah. You see, when you go to the English translations, they will tell you that the Quran came to testify that the Torah and the Gospel are authentic and they are true. But this raises a question. If the Quran came to testify that the Torah and the Gospel are true, it means the Torah and the Gospel are equal to the Quran, and there is no point of Allah asking the Jews and Christians to believe in the Quran, since the Quran has witnessed that the Torah and the Gospel are authentic, are true. The Quran never came to do this. The Quran never came to testify that the Torah, the Torah and the Injil, the Gospel, are authentic books. It came to say that their origin comes from Allah, but mankind have tampered with them. But what the Quran is doing here is corroborating. Corroborating is when you say something, for example, if there is murder, and you tell the police, oh, I was at home with my kids watching a movie. The police go check at home your alibi, and then they say, oh, his alibi corroborates with what he said, i.e. it confirms it. It states there. So corroboration is when something says that something else has truly happened. So the Quran came to corroborate what the messenger has said, that he is a messenger from Allah. And then Allah establishes an eternal truth that should have been sufficient enough for our sheikhs, but they deliberately overlooked it, ignored it, avoided it. And this is it. وَتَفْصِيلَ الْكِتَابِ, and the detailing of the book, i.e. the scripture, explaining what the Quran contains, explaining what Allah wants from us, is undoubtedly from the Lord of the worlds, meaning the one that has explained the Quran, the one that has detailed in the Quran what he wants from us, is Allah, the Lord of the worlds. You can find this ayah in Surah Yunus, that is Surah number 10, the ayah 36 and 37. Muhammad should never ever, of course he didn't, but what the sheikhs say that is, you don't tell me that Rasulullah explained the Quran, because the detailing of the Quran has been made by Allah. That's why there is no tafsir books of the messenger. Anything else that the sheikhs say are lies attributed to the messenger. He never explained it. Why? Because if the messenger of Allah explained something in his time, that something will freeze in that time. But Allah doesn't want that. The Quran is an everlasting book till the end of time. These two ayat, i.e. ayat 36 and 37 from Surah Yunus, from Surah 10, are extremely important, and you should memorize them, especially the part where Allah says, and tafsil al-kitab, the detailing of the book of the Quran is undoubtedly from the Lord of the worlds. That's why the Messenger of Allah could never ever have said anything about or on of the Quran. All he did was understand what Allah said and applied it. He didn't teach people. He didn't hold circles, classes, talks, and explaining the Quran. No, he didn't do that. Never did it. The Quran comes to him. He recites it to people, and he goes on about his life, and people deal with what they have heard, and that's up to them. That's all that is. And please put 1,000 lines under detailing and undoubtedly from the Lord of the worlds. This is why if you want to ask somebody about Islam, tell them, what does Allah say in Al-Quran about this? And what they should say is this: oh, Allah has said ABC, ABD. And then you understand it according to your ability and you act on it. It is not befit of someone to tell you out of their own head what is halal and what is haram. What did our sheikhs do? They say, nope, the messenger is needed to detail the Quran, while Allah says it is him who detailed the book. This is extremely important, my dear sisters and my brothers, and there are, and these concepts are needed in every topic we talk about, especially this one here. Let's go back now to the translations. What these translations say about Allah and his angels do the salat. One of them says, indeed, Allah and his angels give blessings to the Prophet. It doesn't say that in Arabic. It doesn't say give. It says an act of salat. You do a salat. And then he says, O you who have attained faith, pray for blessings. If Allah has blessed the messenger, there is, if the entire earth prayed for blessings, Allah is not gonna add, because I'm just gonna give an example. Yeah, let's say Allah has decided that Muhammad deserves 10 blessings, end of it, and Allah gives that to them. Do we think that if the entire earth prays to Allah to increase that 10 and make it 11, that Allah is gonna do that? Allah has stated in Al-Quran that once he says something, it doesn't change, it doesn't get added to, it doesn't get retrieved. Once the moment Allah says something, it is final. So it doesn't make sense that as Allah and his angels gave blessings to the Prophet, and then he tells people, pray for blessings, i.e. pray for more than what Allah has already given him. It means Allah has not been generous enough. And this is absolutely untrue. What's also strange in all the translations that you're gonna hear, and especially the Arab scholars of before and the translator of the, after all, my dear sisters and my brothers, the translators who translate the meanings of the Quran are doing nothing but translating the sayings of old scholars. And if the translator, for example, is Hanafi, he will take the scholars of the Hanafi school of thought. And if the other one is Maliki, he'll do that. But however, all have agreed that Allah and his angels are already sending their blessings to the Prophet. So again, why would Allah order the believers to pray to him so that he sends more blessings to the Prophet, more than what he already him and the angels have done? Angels, my dear sisters and my brothers, are in the gazillions. It's not like 1,000 million. They are in the gazillions. And if Allah says, I, Allah, and the angels, since he mentioned the angels to mean all of them, it means Allah and gazillions of angels are doing something for the messenger. It just doesn't make sense that Abdus Salam, I, every time I say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Allah says, oops, add one. And somebody, oh, add something. Oh, people are making dua, add, add. It doesn't make sense. Allah has spoken. When Allah speaks, Allah's words are final. For example, I'm gonna take the shaitan analogy, yeah? When Allah issued the ruling that shaitan is going to hellfire and he's gonna be punished, that Allah has decided that the big punishment will go to shaitan, how many people will it take to make dua against shaitan so that Allah increases the punishment? Zero. Because once Allah issues a ruling, it's final. Nothing can beat that ruling. The way this ayah of Allah and His angels are doing the salat has been explained makes Allah somebody who doesn't know what He's doing. He says something and then he keeps adding, and that is not what Allah Ta'ala said. The explanations of these translations, as I said, and most of the translations are financed by the Saudis and Egyptian religious ministries, each of them promoting their respective school of thoughts, beliefs, not the Qur'an's, and this is extremely important. And this is extremely, extremely disturbing. If Allah, my dear sisters and my brothers, had decided that shaitan shall go to hellfire, there is no amount of dua that we can make that's gonna make Allah punish a shaitan more. However, you will find and you will see some strange ways of translating this ayah that Allah and His angels are doing the salat on the messenger. First, they tell us that Allah and the angels have sent their messengers. Okay, once it's done, it's done. And then He orders us to make more dua to Him so that He sends more. You understand where I'm going to. Okay, so let us go and see the translation. Translation number two, it says, surely Allah and His angels send blessings to the Prophet. Again, do pray to bless him, i.e. and send your salam to him. That's why every time people say Muhammad, they say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because in their mind, they are sending more salams to the messenger. They are sending more salat to the messenger and thus increasing his reward more. But what they don't realize is at the same time, they are belittling Allah. Because if Allah and His angels have done already that, you can't add to that. But anyhow, so the translation number three, Allah sends His salat and then He puts in between brackets graces, honors, blessings, mercy on the Prophet, and in between bracket He says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is number one. And also His angels, and in between brackets they say ask Allah to bless and forgive him. So what He's saying is Allah has blessed and honor the messenger. All right. And then He says, oh, and the angels pray to Allah so that He blesses and honors the messenger more than what He already has. Insult number one. And then He goes, oh, you who believe, send your salat, i.e. ask Allah to further bless Muhammad on top of what the angels have already asked. And then He says, and you should greet him, i.e. salute him with the Islamic way of greeting, i.e. salutation, assalamu alaikum. All this translation, time it by zero. It's a pure insult to Allah. And they think they are doing a good job. Translation number four. Why? At the end of this talk, you will understand the true meaning of what Allah meant, and more importantly, how we can apply it in our lives these days. That's what's important here. And you will see why it's completely different than what they say, and why what they are doing is more of an insult rather than some kind of something great they give to the messenger. Translation number four. Surely Allah and His angels send blessings to the Prophet. All you who believe, do pray Allah to bless him and send your salam, prayers for his peace, being in peace, to him in abundance. This makes no sense. Number five, surely Allah and His angels shower serenity. Okay, and He says in between brackets, literally shower prayers on the Prophet. Oh, you who have believed, pray for benediction on him and submit in full submission. Translation number six, Allah and His angels bless the Prophet. Believers, invoke blessings and peace on him. Number seven, God and His angels bless the Prophet. So you who believe, bless him too and give him greetings of peace. So how would the people who lived with the messenger bless him too if Allah has already blessed him? You see, in the Quran, Allah states that He has forgiven all the sins of the messengers, those He committed before becoming a messenger and after He became a messenger. Meaning, Muhammad, when he dies, he will die completely sinless. If the entire earth would pray to Allah to forgive Muhammad, Allah is not going to do it because it already has been done. Same thing for this salat and salam. It already has been done. There is no matter, there is no number of people enough to ask Allah to add more to what He already has done. But who are we? These sheikhs, these scholars don't think. They just say something and they assume that ever, and they just ask of everybody to take what they say and that's it. Don't question what we say. Let's go to the next the translation. Lo, Allah and His angels shower blessings on the Prophet. O ye who believe, ask blessings on him and salute him with a worthy salutation. Alright. Number 9. Allah and His angels send blessings on the Prophet. O ye that believe, send blessings on him and salute him with all respect. Translation number 10. Indeed, Allah sends His blessings upon the Prophet and His angels pray for him. Even though that Allah doesn't say that, Allah says, Allah and the angels. There is no such thing. Allah sends blessings and the angels pray for him. But this is a human's intervention in the Quran, and that's why for the last 1450 years, 14 century and a half, and we still have nothing mastered of Al-Islam. We should become more extremely professional in this Islam. Until today, confusions, and people have no idea what goes on in Islam. Why? Because when mankind put their hands in the Quran and pushed their agendas against the Quran, and then they took away the Quran, it became a matter of this human says, that human says. It no longer is Allah, the God said. It is school of thought against scholar of hadith. And translation number 11. Allah, between brackets, God and His angels bless the Prophet. You who believe, pray for him too and greet him properly. Greet him properly. It doesn't say that in the Quran. You who believe, pray for him too. While he said Allah and His angels bless the Prophet, the Arabic say the people, the humans, should do exactly as Allah and the angels are doing for the messenger. There is no prayer, there is no blessings. But translation number 12, and it's the last one. Indeed, Allah confers, i.e. bestows blessings upon the Prophet, and His angels, between brackets, ask him to do so. I.e. the angels ask of Allah to do so, and Allah obeys the angel. Is that how it is? O you who have believed, ask Allah to confer, to shower more blessings upon him, and ask Allah to grant him peace. Allah has forgiven the messenger all his sins. Allah, in so many parts of the Quran, has given all the safety and security promises to the messenger. That is not, you can pray the entire earth, or you can curse the messenger for the entire earth. He ain't gonna change nothing. As you can see, my dear sisters and my brothers, the translators couldn't bring themselves to agree on one meaning. And that's why we have all these different versions of their interpretations. And the reason, as I said, is that these translators were only translating what the ancient men of religion have said. And since in the 3rd century, when they wrote down the Islam we have today, everything we do goes back to that famous 3rd century. And the arguments and the combats and all the fights keep going. The question, there is a question then. Since Allah had asked the believers in Medina to do something, okay, and the people of Medina had understood that instruction, how could then the scholars disagree about that something? You see, Allah spoke to the people in a manner they understood exactly what He wanted. Why do the sheikhs and the translators and everybody disagree about something? What has happened? The truth of the matter is, as I said, between what Allah has said and when they wrote Islam, 300 years have gone. And it was not exactly documenting what has happened. It is what they think somebody else thought, who heard it from somebody else, from who said something. Maybe he thought something, perhaps nothing, and it all got lost in all this chain of so many years that have gone by. This paper that I'm talking, whatever I'm going to say here, will shed more light on this oftentimes manipulated ayah. And this ayah has been manipulated for the very wrong reasons. It's been misused, abused. And after you finish listening to my talk, and I will put this also in PDF, and I intend, inshallah, in the future to have a small website where I can put all my talks, notes, and everything for you guys to download them. Once you finish listening and reading to my talk, you will get a far much better understanding about this ayah, the context in which it was revealed, and most importantly, what to do with it in our times today that the Prophet is not with us. Because the confusion and difference of views came about, as I said, in the 3rd century. And today we are forced to apply an Islam of the 3rd century, not an Islam of the Quran. And this is our problem. That's why you hear this Salaf always go back to the righteous predecessors. What they don't tell you is they're talking about the 3rd century. And the reason behind this paper, my dear sisters and my brothers, is because I personally, when I say Muhammad, I say the Prophet, I never say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. People get offended. Sometimes I say, oh, Muhammad did, and the person in front of me goes, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And and all this kind of, is they continue my sentence for me. Sometimes I tell people, I don't say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Why are you saying it for me? And they say, oh, it's an order of Allah in the Quran. And go, really? And they mention this ayah, Allah had these angels. And then the conversation starts for him. I ask them question. And then after 10 minutes of trying to explain to them that is not what it's meant, people are still, it's almost like I'm selling them some high intensity drugs or something. But anyhow, at the end of this talk, you'll get a better understanding about the context in which this ayah was revealed and what to do with it in our times. All the translations that I spoke of right now are on www.quran.com, and it's all there. I haven't altered, I just omitted those that are similar, but I've reported everything. I want to go back to translator number 3, the one who took the liberty of adding what he says. He, Allah says in Al-Quran, Allah and his angels, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتُهُ, certainly, verily, Allah and his angels. But him, how he translated it, he said, Allah sends his salat, and puts that in between brackets, graces, honors, blessings, mercy, and on the Prophet, and then he put in between brackets, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he adds, and also his angels. But Allah didn't say that. Allah said Allah and the angels at the same time. But he split it. Why? Because he wanted to push an understanding of the school of thought that when the sheikhs speak about this ayah, they say, oh, when Allah sends, do his salat, does his salat, he means this. When the angels do their salat, they mean that. And what Allah has asked of humans to do is this. And that's why he split his translation into 3 distinct parts. Allah does this, and he, also his angels ask Allah, that is that, O you who believe, send your salat. And this is extremely dangerous. We have become like the Jews and Christians. One day I had the opportunity to meet Ahmed Didat, Allah has mercy on him, because people used to feel good about how he used to ridicule the priest and things like that. And I told him, you're doing it wrong. That's not what Allah has asked. And I told him one day, if I go, I said, you use the Quran in English. And yeah, and I go, which version of the translations are you using? Christian can use the, they can bring the translation of the meaning of the Quran in English for this particular ayah, 13 different versions of translations. Which one is true? You see? And I told him, what you're doing is not that, and it's not what Allah said. But anyhow, the malpractice of this kind of translations is found throughout any translations of the meaning of the Quran. This is why I always encourage you, whenever you wanna understand something, a ruling in the Quran, something, when you look at one ayah, look at all kinds of translations, as many as you can. And the moment you have a slight doubt, go back to someone you trust and ask them. Because what you are reading is not what Allah says, it's what the school of thoughts have said. To get a better idea about these translations, let us just take the 2 most important parts of this ayah. One part, it says what Allah and his angels did. And then the other part is what the believers should copy Allah and his angels and do. And the person to whom whatever is being done is one person, and that is the Prophet. Because it is by putting these two facts together that we can see the big mess created around it. Because even though this ayah was directly speaking to those who coexisted with the Prophet, yet the sheikhs, the scholars, the school of thoughts, the hadith narratives, opinions, as a whole, the men of religion, wanted to take this ayah, as I said, which was limited to a certain time for a specific event and directed to a specific people. What they did was they ignored all that, the time factor, and they made it eternal until judgment day comes. And because of this, all they needed was to invent a new meaning for it, other than what it truly means. And from here originated all types of confusion, differences, and obscurity about the meaning of this simple instruction. What and how did Allah and His angels do their salat on the Prophet? And does Allah have a salat in the first place to make? Does He pray? Does Allah praise what He created every time He mentions His name? So in the Quran, He mentioned the name of Muhammad a few times, but He never said, my salat, my blessings be upon him. He just said Muhammad, like He said Musa, like He said Isa, like He said anybody else. If that is the case, then why didn't He, i.e. Allah, do that with Jibreel? Jibreel is far more important in the sight of Allah than Muhammad. Jibreel is a... But anyhow, I have a talk on YouTube which talks about Jibreel, and it explains who Jibreel is, and you will find the great value of Jibreel. Why not with Adam? Why is it only Muhammad? Why not Jesus? Why not Moses? Why? Why singling him out? See, there is a huge need to understand this ayah in the context it was revealed in. Because when it was cut off from its context, it was easy for the men of religion to force it to mean whatever they wanted, but what it only means. You see, the saying of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, every time somebody says Muhammad or refers to him as the messenger of Allah or the prophet or anything else, they say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Why? Because of this problematic confusion. And after that, everything broke loose. Before I carry on, I have about 7 kittens, and they might play and you might hear some noise. Please just ignore that. They are there. All right. But anyhow, the controversy, there is a huge controversy about this ayah, because nowhere in the Quran, from the beginning to its end, not from near, not from far, does Allah ever mention Muhammad by name or by title as a messenger or prophet, then follows it up with the famous expression Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam or any other praises for that matter. Allah, just like He mentioned Ya Musa, He says Ya Muhammad, Ya Isa, Ya Sulaiman, Ya Dawood. He just uses the name and of it. But this then begs the question, if Allah doesn't say it, so why would He order the believers who coexisted with the Prophet and then us to say this every time His name is mentioned? How come He asks them and us to do something that Himself doesn't do? Especially that He has rebuked in the Quran anyone who says what they don't do. O you who believe, why do you say what you do not do? It is most loathsome, very hateful to Allah that you say what you do not do. And this is in Surah As-Saff 61, ayah 2 and 3. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِمَ تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَن تَقُولُوا مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. So Allah not only hates someone who says what He doesn't do, as a matter of fact, He puts it into practice. He orders us to say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and He doesn't say it Himself. But no, Allah will not order us not to do something and do it. That's not Allah. You see, Muhammad by name in the Quran has been mentioned 4 times. Muhammad. Alright? Prophet, messenger, it's countless times. One of them is when Allah says, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ. Muhammad is nothing but only a messenger before whom many messengers have been and gone. Ali Imran, that's surah number 2, ayah 144. Pay attention. Watch how Allah just mentions Muhammad's name without any extra embellishments or praises. Just Muhammad. Muhammad and of it. Your ears will hurt you when I say Muhammad without following it with Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Do you know why? Because your brain is brainwashed into hearing Muhammad and then the title of praises after him. When Muhammad gets mentioned by itself, it sounds strange to you at first. But the more you practice it, the more it becomes normal. We certainly cannot be more respectful and more loving towards Muhammad than Allah the Almighty, can we? You see, the man of religion, however, seems to think that they can be more polite than Allah, because every time they mention Muhammad, a list of praises follow. Until saying the name of Muhammad by itself seems so unusual, so unnatural, so incredibly incriminating. You say Muhammad and you don't say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you feel a guilt, you feel something eating inside you. Say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, push it, come on. And then Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and you feel, So we're better than Allah in this context? But to add salt to injury, there is an invented hadith narrative that is extremely insulting to Allah in the first place and very narcissistic to the messenger himself. Abu Huraira, the famous Abu Huraira, and I will make a talk about this man, reports that the messenger of Allah said, alright, what did he say, Abu Huraira? رغم أنف رجل ذكرت عنده فلم يصلي علي. May the nose of a man be rubbed in dust. You see, when we male, when the testosterone get into our heads and we get aggressive, we become like two beasts and we fight. The strong man will defeat the weak man, and then to further humiliate him, he will grab his head and rub it on the dust. That is showing extreme disgrace towards the one who lost it. So to the Arabs, if you tell somebody, I'm gonna come and rub your nose on the, they mean not only you're gonna defeat them, you're gonna beat them, but you're gonna actually totally humiliate them. So it's very insulting to an Arab. So the messenger uses that analogy, that anyone whom I am mentioned before him, but does not send salat upon me. And this hadith narrative is reported by Muslim and Tirmidhi and few others. There we have it. Humiliation is on anyone who hears the name of Muhammad mentioned but doesn't follow it up with the famous Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Which or who has said Muhammad without saying Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Did it say Salam? It's Allah. Allah has mentioned a few times in the Quran without Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Isn't that insulting to Allah? Isn't that very narcissistic to the messenger to force people to say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? I don't want to send my salam to you. I don't care who you are, someone might say. No, you gotta do it or you are... No! You see, doing acts of goodness have to come from you, not you being forced. Just like Allah does not accept a sin from someone who has been forced into committing it, Allah will not accept a good deed when you are forced to do it, despite your nose and you do it. Allah will not accept it. It has to originate from you. Another ayah, the second ayah. Allah says, مَا كَانَ مُحَمَّدٌ أَبَا أَحَدٍ مِنْ رِجَالِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. The strange thing, Muhammad was not the father of any of your men, but he's only a messenger of Allah. What's actually strange about this ayah that I just read is that it is in the same surah, Surah Al-Ahzab. This ayah is number 40, and the ayah where Allah does his salat is 56. There is 16 ayahs in between two. How come Allah in the same surah tells us Muhammad is not Muhammad, my salat upon him, my salat and the angels upon him? Nothing of that nonsense. Muhammad and of it. And this ayah was descended to bust a myth that the Arabs had. They believed that if a man sponsored a kid and adopted him in his family, then the man becomes like his generic father, like genetic one, that's it. And you know the story of Zayd and everything, but this is not the purpose of that story. But here, so notice how Allah just mentions Muhammad, no fancy praises, titles, just Muhammad. He's not the father of any of your men and of it. If Allah's salat was to say, my salat be upon him, he would have said, Muhammad, my salat be upon him, was not a father of any of your men. No, just Muhammad. And as I said, this is just 16 ayahs before the famous 56 ayah. But the sheikhs, the men of religion, they lie. They lie through their teeth. To push their agenda, they are willing to sacrifice the entire Quran. Lie to us, hide part of it. As long as what they want to push onto us stands. But you see, in all this, alhamdulillah, that we have the Quran with us. Allah Ta'ala says in the third ayah, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, as those who have believed and did the righteous deeds, and believed in what was descended upon Muhammad. وَآمَنُوا بِمَا نُزِّلَ عَلَى مُحَمَّدِ. And he didn't praise him, he didn't say anything fancy schmancy about him, just that was descended on Muhammad. And then he said, وَهُوَ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ, and it is indeed the truth about the Quran from their Lord. Again, notice how Allah, Muhammad, the name Muhammad is just mentioned as it is. Even though, if Allah had praised his messenger in this ayah, that would have added a lot more status to his messenger. But he just mentioned him by name. He could have said, my wonderful messenger, the best of the messenger, the top-notch one, the whatever Allah would say, it would add a lot of value to the messenger. Guess what? He didn't. Nothing fancy here. Muhammad, just Muhammad. Imagine if Allah had said, and those who believed and did righteous deeds and believed in what was descended on Muhammad, upon whom and my angels have descended my salat, and who is also praised by the angels and all the believers, and it that would have been fantastic. Nope. Allah goes, and those who believe in what has been descended upon Muhammad. End of it. Ayah number 4. Allah says, Muhammadun Rasulullah. Walladhina ma'ahu. Muhammad, the messenger of Allah, and those who are with him. Again, notice, no embellishments, no over-the-top praises, no upon whom I have descended my salat, and who is also praised by the angels and the believers, none of that. The ayah is simple. It just states that Muhammad was a person that Allah chose as a messenger. End of it. Or not, had Allah seen someone more competent than Muhammad, he would have picked that person up. But when Allah wanted to choose a messenger, he found that Muhammad was the best that would fit the mission. End of it. So my dear sisters and my brothers, as you can see here, I've read to you the 4 ayat from the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it clear that Muhammad is nothing else but a human being that has been sent by Allah ta'ala to do something very special, deliver a divine message to mankind. Because Allah could have used an angel, but an angel is not like us. And Allah has stated in the Quran that whenever he wants to send a message, he would send it with somebody of the nature of those he is sent to. Let us be clear about one thing. Muhammad is just a messenger like the many that had come before him. He is not the best of them. He is not the top of them. He is not the best son of Adam. He is absolutely not a thing. He is just a human being that Allah has sent him. This is why Allah in the Quran orders Muhammad to tell us, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Tell them, Ya Muhammad, I am just a human like you. Strange thing is, this ayah is at the end of Surah Al-Kahf, Surah number 18, and this ayah is 110, that Muslims read every Friday, seeking reward, and then they go, as they read that Muhammad is nothing but a human being like you and like me, and then they go and tell you, oh, he is the best of all the prophets, he is this and he is that, something that, because I don't know how Muslims use their capacity in the mind, I don't know. You see, when it comes to his physicality, the message I'm talking here, he is just like any other human being. He eats, He drinks, he walks, he goes to the toilet, he gets tired and sins. That's why Allah forgave his sins. He farts, he poops, he does everything. His nose gets itchy, whatever happens to us humans, it happens to him. I know when I said he sins, this will come maybe as a surprise to you, and some people jump at me and said, look, Allah says he forgave him his sins. They go, yeah, Allah just said like that, the messenger doesn't have sin. Well, you mean Allah is lying? The messenger doesn't have sins and Allah tells him, I forgive you sins? Is that what he's saying? You see, this, how come the messenger commits a sin? Because he is a human being like us. Even in the Quran, Allah tells him that when you look at women and you like them and you fancy them and you desire them, you can't have them. In the Quran it says this. That's why the Quran cannot come to the surface. It cannot be the sole authority in Islam, because the Quran has got this absolutely beautiful picture that the sheikhs have hidden for the last 1400 years. Well, much to that thing that not only did Muhammad have sins, but he also was going to commit them in the future. This is why Allah, when he sent down to him the big news, what was the big news, ya Allah? That Allah has forgiven all the sins, previous sins of Muhammad and those who are whom he is going to do in the future. In Surah 48, it's called Surah Al-Fath. The ayah, at the beginning of the ayah, number 1 and 2, Allah says, إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا. Indeed, we have unlocked for you a clear triumph. You've triumphed, ya Muhammad. What is this triumph, ya Allah? لِيَغْفِرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأْخَرَ. So that Allah forgives you, Muhammad, your past sins and the upcoming ones. Meaning the messenger after this ayah did commit sins. He is a human being like you and like me. But the only difference that sets him apart from you and me and the rest of the entire humanity is that yuha ilayh, who is given the revelation, he gets the revelation from Allah. And this again, as I said, is at the very end of Surah Al-Kahf, Surah 18, ayah 110. So when someone argues with you, you can be 100% sure and you can rest assured that they ignore much of the Quran. That's why they're arguing. Those who know the Quran will not argue with you. Even if they claim a sheikh and they argue with you, it's because they have no clue of the Quran. See, all the praiseful claims and the extra titles and invention of the man of religion, they are just like that, inventions of the man of religion. And they didn't have any right to these claims and praises, yet they invented them, lied about them, and by doing that they have completely alienated the Quran, and they carried on with their lies until people no longer believe what Allah says. You tell them Allah says this in the Quran, and they tell you this or that hadith says that, the messenger of Allah said that, until they wrote Allah and Muhammad on the same line. Most masjid, anywhere you go, it's always Allah and Muhammad on the same line, equals. Hey, where have you become? It's almost like people say, do not trust what Allah says, don't trust the Quran, and trust in Muhammad and the scholars. And this is a big, big problem indeed. The ayah 56, my dear sisters and my brothers, I think I should stop here and carry on with the next topic in the next talk. Oh, okay, to part 2 then. Assalamu alaikum.